remember that moment. Where were you when John F. Kennedy was assassinated? I don't remember that one. I remember Bobby probably better. In fact, I was just a youngster, Bobby Kennedy, when he was assassinated. And we were getting ready for school, and my mom, the phone rang, and the phone never rings in the morning back then. And she goes, "Bobby?" And first I thought it was my Uncle Bob, but no, it was Bobby Kennedy. And I remember that moment very clear. Where were you when 9/11 happened? I can remember that very clearly also. Can you think of any other moments of where were you? Very profound moments that we have had a chance to live in. Well, there are some out there. What about this one? Where were you when this particular announcement was made?
This is the CBS Evening News with Walter Cronkite.
Good evening. In a landmark ruling, the Supreme Court today legalized abortions. The majority in cases from Texas and Georgia said that the decision to end a pregnancy during the first 3 months belongs to the woman and her doctor, not the government. Thus, the anti-abortion laws of 46 states were rendered unconstitutional.
All right, that happened 43 years ago Friday. We are celebrating, if you can call it celebrating, the 43rd anniversary of Roe versus Wade. And many of you might not put it in the same category as the Twin Towers and the landing of the moon and others, but you know, I believe that we should consider it because it has had a major impact on our nation. In fact, a far greater impact. If we look at this chart here, there's actually three columns. The first one is so tiny you can't even see it, but the first number is 2,977. That is the number of lives that were lost in the 9/11 events and the tragic loss of life. But when you look at the overall impact relative to the next column, the red one, 1.5 million, that is the total number of people Americans who have been killed in wars in the history of the United States since 1775. The total loss of life due to war in the United States. And it is that right-hand column is the number of infants that have been killed in the womb through abortion. And at the rally Friday, they actually said 58 million. So we're actually 1 million higher than what this statistic has told us. So I think we can say that was a very, very profound moment in the history of the United States. And what a loss of human potential. So today, 2 days after the anniversary, I'd like to reflect a little bit on this topic. And you're probably arguing, well, this topic has been hashed out for 43 years. What more can be said? And I'm going to say a lot more can be said. And nobody has said it better, as far as I can tell, than Gianna Jensen. I don't know if you know Gianna Jensen, but she can speak to this topic very well because Gianna has been through an abortion herself, and she survived. She had gone through a saline abortion and survived and lives to tell about it, and she has one of the best pro-life speeches ever. In fact, that's the title of a video. I'd like to share her testimony. We're going to spend quite a bit of time looking at her testimony this morning, and she's speaking, I believe, to the Parliament in England. I know it's a foreign country. It looks like a governmental body of some type. I thought I saw what looked like Margaret Thatcher on the wall, so I'm guessing she is speaking to the English Parliament. It's a large stone building, so it's real echoey. There's a lot of reverb and echo, but hopefully you can understand this message and hear her testimony today. Let's take a listen.
I'm adopted, and my biological mother was 17, and so was my biological father. She was 7.5 months pregnant when she decided to go to Planned Parenthood, which is the largest abortion provider in the world, and they counseled her to have a late-term saline abortion, which is a saline salt solution that is injected into the mother's womb. baby gulps that solution, it burns the baby inside and out, and then she is to deliver a dead baby within 24 hours. And to everyone's great shock and surprise, I didn't arrive dead, but alive, on April the 6th, 1977, in a Los Angeles County abortion clinic. What's fantastic about this, about the perfect timing of my arrival, is that the abortionist was not on duty yet. So he wasn't even given the opportunity to continue on with his plan for my life, which was death. And I know that I'm in a government building, and a beautiful one it is, and I love your country as well as my own. But I know in the age that we live in, it is not at all politically correct to say the name of Jesus Christ in places like this, to bring him into these sorts of meetings, because his name can make people so terribly uncomfortable. But I didn't survive so I could make everyone comfortable. I survived so I could stir things up a bit. And I have a great time doing it. And so I was delivered alive, as I've already said, after 18 hours. I should be blind, I should be burned, I should be dead. And yet I'm not. You know what is fantastic vindication? Is the fact that the abortionist had to sign my birth certificate. So I know who he is. And it also says, for any skeptic listening, on my medical records, born during saline abortion. Ha! They didn't win. I've done some research on the man that performed the abortion on me. And his clinics are the largest chain of clinics in the United States of America, and they gross $70 million a year. I read a quote from him at some point several years ago, and he said, I have aborted over 1 million babies and I consider it my passion. I tell you these things because, listen, ladies and gentlemen, we are in an interesting battle. Whether we realize it or not, in this world, it is a battle between life and death. What side are you on? So a nurse called an ambulance and had me transferred to a hospital, which is absolutely miraculous. Generally, the practice at the time and up until 2002 was, in my country, was to end the life of an abortion survivor by strangulation, suffocation, leaving the baby there to die, or throwing the baby away. But on August the 5th, 2002, my extraordinary President Bush signed into law the Born Alive Infants Protection Act to prevent that from occurring anymore. You see, we're playing for keeps. We're playing for, I mean, I'm hoping to be hated by the time that I die so that I can feel God about me and understand what it was to be hated. I mean, he was hated. Christ was hated. And not that I look forward to being hated, but I know along my journey, I know I'm already hated because I declare life. I say, you didn't get me. The silent Holocaust didn't win over me. And my mission, ladies and gentlemen, among many things, is this: to infuse humanity into a debate that we have just compartmentalized and set on a shelf and said it is an issue. We have removed our emotions. We are becoming harder. Do you really want that? How much are you willing to take, and how much are you willing to risk to speak the truth in love and graciousness and stand up and at least be willing to be hated? Or at the end of the day, is it all about you? Or me? And so, after that, I was placed in an emergency foster care home where they decided they didn't like me very well, and as I'm fond of saying, I don't know how you could not adore me right from the start. What is wrong with these people? But they didn't. You see, I've been hated since conception. By so many, and loved by so many more, but most especially by God. I'm his girl. You don't mess with God's girl. I got a sign on my forehead that says, you better be nice to me because my father runs the world. So after I was placed in the mean home,